All right, welcome to module 3, where we're now turning our attention from how it is that parties and party leaders and party members operate in order to win elections. We're going to turn our attention towards the consequences of elections and what happens when the election outcomes turn into the political reality. So we're now moving from the electoral system to the governing system. This lecture is about partisanship in Congress, and I want to talk briefly about what happens with a particular party makeup in both houses of Congress. I've mentioned before that party leaders want more rather than less, more rather than fewer seats in Congress and in the state legislatures, because obviously they want the majority, and then if you have a bigger majority, you have the ability to lose some votes from your own party and still pass the legislation that you want to pass. So the point of competing in elections, particularly legislative elections, and in the next lecture I'll look at the partisan administration, so we'll talk about the consequences of executive elections, but in legislative elections the point is to try to win a legislative majority in order to be able to pass legislation to forward your policy priorities. Now, this is not a class on the operation of Congress. I'm teaching that class in the spring term. You can take that class as well to see what, in much more detail, it's like in Congress. But basically, Congress is a machine for turning policy ideas into policy outcomes. And the only way that you can operate that machine is if you have control over the machine. And legislative majority is the clearest and easiest way to control that machine. So what parties are looking to do, of course, is to get a majority. Now, it's possible to crank out policy outcomes without those outcomes being led by the majority, or with a very slim majority that is actually fractured enough that party doesn't have enough unity to pass its priorities on its own. It's also possible in a divided Congress, where the House of Representatives is controlled by one party and the Senate is controlled by another party, to get policy outcomes. And I'll talk a little bit about that, but that is far more difficult, and in fact it's become more and more difficult as the parties themselves have moved apart in their policy priorities. When the parties are relatively close on certain issues, and there have been times throughout American history when the two major parties have, if not necessarily have overlapping policy ideas, have differences of opinion that are relatively close enough that you can compromise. And you can have the Senate controlled by one party and the House controlled by another party, and be able to actually pass bills that work for enough people to pass, to get a majority in both houses of Congress. And one of the things, of course, that's difficult about a bicameral legislature is you need a majority in both houses to get something done. So when you have a unified Congress, that's obviously the best. Both houses in the same party's hands is best for that party. Even when you have divided Congress, you still can get majorities in both houses. When the parties' ideologies and policy preferences are farther apart, it becomes very difficult to get anything done except when you have unified control. And of course, unified control also requires having a president who is from the same party, who's not going to veto that particular bill. So partisanship in Congress is the relative strength of party loyalty and the relative distance apart on particular questions of the two parties has a big impact on how well this machine can be used to crank out policy outcomes. During the 1990s, the Democratic Party and the Republican Party were similar enough on a lot of issues. And in fact, when I first started teaching American politics in the 90s, one of the most common complaints that seems very quaint now is that the two parties were too similar, that there wasn't realistic choice, that it was essentially a one-party system with two different party labels. What that meant was that it was possible for a democratically controlled Senate and a Republican controlled House of Representatives, or a Republican controlled Congress and a Democratic president, to come together and pass legislation. And in fact, that's what happened quite a lot throughout the 1990s, both in the Bush administration, the first Bush administration, and in the Clinton administration, because the two parties actually had a decent amount of common ground on questions like tax policy and financial regulation or deregulation, issues like welfare reform, on crime prevention and police reform. So the two parties actually had similar enough ideas that they could get things done. By the 21st century, the two parties were moving apart, throughout the Bush administration, the Democratic and the Republican parties' positions became farther and farther apart, to the point where it was necessary, in order to have major outcomes, that you have control over both houses of Congress as well as the presidency, unified government. We haven't had very many periods of unified government or very many years of unified government in the past 20 years. And during those periods of time, what does happen is the party that's in control of the White House and both houses of Congress tries to use that period, which they know is probably going to be brief, to get as much done as possible before the next election or the election after that, where it's likely that you're going to lose control. Now, why is it so important in Congress to have control over the majority? Well, the majority gives you some things beyond just enough votes to pass legislation. Congress is a partisan institution in the sense that it's organized along party lines. The leadership of each of the chambers is determined by the majority party, and the leadership of each chamber has control over the legislative process. The Speaker of the House is technically just chosen by the majority of members of the House of Representatives. But when you have a party caucus, and that's actually what parties are called within each chamber, the party caucus, when you have, say, a Democratic caucus that has the majority of seats, what you can do as the Democratic caucus is caucus together and decide who your candidate for Speaker is going to be. And it might be that that candidate only has, 150 supporters, which is not enough to pass to elect a speaker in the full House of 435. But if you have 220 members of the House of Representatives in the Democratic Party, and you have 150 people who support a particular speaker, the other 70 people, the way it works and the way it has worked, this has not yet broken down, is when they lose the intra-party vote for who the speaker is going to be, essentially the party primary, they're then going to vote for their party's candidate when it comes to the full House vote. It doesn't have to be that way. It really could be that, let's say that there were 30 disaffected Democrats who didn't like the choice for speaker. They could technically work with the Republicans, who are in the minority, to come up with a Speaker of the House those 30 would support and that the Republican Party would support, and elect a Speaker of the House from the Republican Party, or elect a Speaker of the House from the Democratic Party from that smaller group. That doesn't happen because party loyalty hasn't broken down that far. And it's possible for it to break down that far, but that would be a pretty severe breakdown of party loyalty. But the Speaker of the House is chosen intra-party. The Senate Majority Leader is chosen intra-party. So for even though it doesn't have to be this way technically, for all intents and purposes, whatever the majority party is chooses the leadership. The leadership then controls the flow. They control the legislative agenda. The Speaker of the House and the Senate Majority Leader are essentially the chairperson, the super chairperson of each of the chambers. Now, the legislative process doesn't just run through the whole membership of the chamber. What happens first is that legislation is introduced and then it's sent to committees. And the committee is made up of members of each party in proportion to their percentage of control over that chamber. So if there are 60 Republican senators and 40 Democratic senators, 60% of all of the committees are going to be Republicans. So if you have a committee of 11 members, there are going to be 7 Republicans and 4 Democrats. If the chamber is more evenly divided, if there are 51 Republicans and 49 Democrats, then there are going to be 6 Republicans and 5 Democrats on that committee. Now, what's most important is who's the chair. The committees are chaired by a person from the majority party. And in that committee, then, that person controls the legislative agenda. Committee chairs have powers that other members of the committee don't. They control the agenda, they control subpoena power, they can advance or prevent bills from advancing. And so not just which party controls the chamber, but which individual controls a particular committee is really important. Now, there are rules in both chambers that allow for supermajorities to override the choices of these leaders. So on a committee, that I believe it's in the House of Representatives, if two-thirds of the members of the committee want to advance a bill for a vote, despite the chair not wanting to do so, then that bill would be advanced for a vote. That doesn't happen very often, and it would be an unusual circumstance for it to occur, but it's in the rules, and it does and can happen. The same thing is true at the chamber level, that if the Speaker of the House doesn't want to bring a bill up for vote, but two-thirds of the members of the House, there's some kind of, I'm not really great on parliamentary procedure, but there's some kind of petition that can be advanced, and if enough people vote, so basically if you have Democrats and Republicans voting together to advance something, they can override the choice of the Speaker. But for all intents and purposes and in practicality 100% of the time, the flow of legislation through each chamber of Congress is controlled by committee chairs first and then by the party leadership. How do you get to be a committee chair? Well, first you have to be assigned to a committee and then you have to be chosen to be the chair of that committee. Both of those things are done by the leadership of the party. And so within that chamber. So the leadership team of the Democrats in the House of Representatives, because they have the majority right now, they choose which Democrats go on each of the committees, and then they choose which of those Democrats is going to be the chairperson. In the Senate, the chair of the committee is actually the senior member of the majority party, unless that person has been chair for, I think that there's an 8-year and it's possibly 6-year. I honestly, again, don't know all the specifics, but there's essentially a term limit that you can only be the chair of committees for a certain amount of time, and then once your time is up, the next most senior member gets it. So in the Senate, seniority rules are still in place. The House of Representatives used to have seniority rules, but that got changed in a wave of reform in the 1970s. So the rules of each chamber of Congress are actually decided by the membership of that chamber, and essentially by the majority party controls the rules. The majority can change the rules. Now, there are only certain times when you can change the rules, and you know, one of the things that is being talked about now is getting rid of the legislative filibuster in the Senate. In order to do that, that requires just a majority of senators to vote for that rule change, but rules can only be adopted or changed outside the filibuster at the beginning of each session of Congress, before essentially the rules have been adopted. So when a new Congress is sworn in, the rules are in abeyance. They don't just roll over, and the new members of Congress vote to either accept the old rules and put them in force or to change those rules, and that's a strict majority rule only. So it's at that moment that the majority party can, in either chamber, change the rules. In the Senate, that's the one time when you can override the filibuster, because the filibuster rule doesn't exist yet. Once you adopt rules that include the filibuster, if you want to then change the rules later in the session, you have to overcome the filibuster, because the filibuster is now in place. So parties control the rules of each chamber, but they only get one opportunity. Now, in the House, where there is no filibuster, the rules can be changed at any time because it just takes a simple majority to pass any kind of rule change. So the rules of each chamber are decided within that chamber. They don't have to be decided by both chambers. They don't have to be signed off by the president. They're decided within that chamber, and they're strictly majority only. So the majority party controls not only the flow of legislation, but the actual rules as well. So if the leadership of the House of Representatives wanted to get Democrats to change the rules to actually make committee chairs be the senior member of that committee instead of assigned by the leadership, they could do that at any particular time. So this is an important way in which partisanship plays a role in the way that Congress functions. Each House of Congress is self-regulating, and those rules are in the hands of the party that has the majority. So that's definitely one of the reasons why it's important to control the majority. Now, as I said, in the Senate, and this is worth noting, the only time that really, at this point in history, is useful is at the beginning of the session. Because as soon as the rules are adopted that include a filibuster, that filibuster requirement of 60 votes is now going to prevent the bare majority from making a rule change. So it has to be done at the beginning of the term. Now, legislation flows through first committees and then through the body as a whole, and then it goes to the other chamber where it has to be passed by a majority with the same words, the same commas, the same everything. It will go from, let's say the House passes a bill, it goes to the Senate, and then it goes to the committees in the Senate. It doesn't just go for a full floor vote at the Senate. And the Senate Majority Leader controls the flow of that. Let's say that we have divided Congress, which we have right now, and the House of Representatives passes a bill, and it goes over to the Senate, and the Senate Majority Leader doesn't ever want to bring that up for a vote. One, you could send it to a committee that has a chairperson that's going to have that bill, kill that bill in committee. Or two, you could actually just, when it comes out of committee, just decide not to hold a vote on it. That is one of the things that is possible. A very high-profile example of this in the current world is that the House of Representatives back in June passed a $3 trillion follow-up to the CARES Act for pandemic relief that the Senate never took up and was never going to take up, and the Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell basically said, we're never even going to vote on this. We would beat it anyway, but we're not even going to make our members vote on it. Now, why would you not want a bill that you know you could beat because you have the majority to come up for a vote? Well, that's because one of the things about parties in Congress after an election is that there is no after the election period that isn't also now before the next election. So while elections have consequences in the sense that they can change and often do change the makeup of the chambers, increasing or decreasing the size of one party's majority or flipping control from one party to another, nothing is permanent. Every 2 years, there are congressional elections. And in the House of Representatives, every seat's up for election every 2 years. In the Senate, one third of the seats are up for election every 2 years. So the Senate can change less quickly than the House of Representatives. But essentially, what happens is let's say you win an election and you increase your majority. You're now looking towards the next election where what you want to do is either enlarge your majority or hold on to it. You definitely don't want to lose your majority by the next election. 2 years is not a ton of time in political time. It's not a ton of time in terms of policymaking. It's very difficult to have a brand new bill that gets introduced and passed through both houses of Congress in a 2 year period. What's more typical is that a major piece of legislation will take multiple sessions of Congress in order to be able to be passed. So one of the things that party leaders are always looking towards when they are deciding on what bills to advance and what bills to hang on to is, what will that bill do for the next election? More specifically, what will that bill do to potentially vulnerable members of that party in the next election cycle? And so if you have a bunch of, in the Senate, let's say, there's 33 seats up for vote. If you have 23 senators in your party who are up for election, you want to, in the year running up to that election, you want to make sure that you can shield those senators from difficult votes that are going to cost them, potentially cost them the election back home. Party leaders are always paying attention to what kind of consequences their members are going to have to face if they vote yes or no on particular kinds of bills. And so that is essentially the main partisan calculation. Not can we pass this bill or can we defeat this bill? That's a consideration. And of course, that determines whether or not this machine, this policymaking machine, can be used to crank out policy outcomes. Do we have the votes? But do we want to actually have the votes taken to either defeat or advance this particular bill? And the only question that gets asked in follow-up to do we want to take the votes is, what will this do for our members in the next election? So elections have consequences in the sense that they create the balance of Democrats and Republicans in each of the houses of Congress. They determine who has the majority. They show how strong that majority is. They give control over the committees as well as the leadership, which controls the agenda, to one party or the other. But that majority has to be used, or is used, gently and gingerly and with the next election in mind. There's no such thing as a post-election period in American politics. There is technically, the new Congress will be sworn in at the beginning of January 2021, and that follows the 2020 election. That's after the election. But already, party leaders and party members are already thinking about the next election cycle. Let's say that the Democratic Party takes over the Senate and expands its majority in the House of Representatives and wins the White House so that it has unified government. You would think, great, they can do whatever they want. Now, yes, they can, but one of the things that all of the party leaders want in both houses, as well as the president, is to continue to have unified government after the 2022 elections and then go into the 2024 presidential and congressional elections with looking good and continuing to have the American people support the candidates in that party. So they're going to be using their unified government carefully. And part of the problem is that carefully means, of course, you want to not do things which will alienate voters in the future by passing things that people don't like, but you also don't want to alienate people who've elected you by not passing things that you said you would. So there's a really big dance. And really, because each House of Congress is controlled, the legislative process is controlled by the party leaders, the Speaker and the leadership team in the House, and the majority leader in the Senate, and then the committee chairs, who are really a part of the leadership team as well, because they're selected by the leadership team, the body-wide leadership team, and now they are signed on for that agenda. They want to use their control over the legislative process to make sure that they keep promises, but not do things which are going to alienate voters in the future. And oddly and ironically, one of the things that can happen is you can hurt yourself in the future by delivering on promises you made that got you elected. Why would that be? It seems crazy, but the reason why that is because the American people might love an idea. They might love the idea of, you know, all of this, stimulus money, infrastructure spending, tax cuts for the middle class. The majority of Americans might like that. A bunch of people in all the key districts, the swing districts, might like that. The people who voted for the president might like that. As soon as a piece of policy is turned from a promise, which inspires support, into an actual policy, then it creates winners and losers. Then it creates the possibility of being attacked for specifics. And it is problematic that when you give the American people what they want, sometimes they realize that they didn't want exactly that thing, or maybe they didn't actually want the thing, or they didn't think through the consequences of, like, oh, all this money spent on infrastructure means that money can't be spent somewhere else, or now we have this huge deficit, or the tax cuts for the middle class actually cut the ability to spend more money. Whatever it happens to be, turning promises into actual policy outcomes is somewhat treacherous, and elected officials know this. People who rise to party leadership definitely know that one of the problems with governing successfully is that when you keep promises, sometimes that hurts you in the next cycle. For sure, one of the biggest promises that the Democrats and as a candidate, Barack Obama, made in the 2008 election was healthcare reform. And then they did it. They delivered on healthcare reform. They delivered the Affordable Care Act. And it really was pleasing to a lot of people, and it was displeasing to a lot of people. What happened was in 2010, there was a wave election that lost Congress, both houses of Congress, for the Democrats to the Republicans. And for the next 6 years, a Democratic president, Barack Obama, had to have an oppositional, a Republican-controlled Congress, largely because of the success of turning that promise of healthcare reform into a reality. And now the reality has a specific target on it, right? Now, Republicans have been running quite successfully on repeal and replace, and they failed to do so, and partly because once you repeal something that already exists, now you've delivered on your promise, but you've also given something for people to be pissed off about. And then if you don't replace it with anything, then you failed to keep that promise. But if you do replace it with something, you've now put yourself in the same position that the other side put themselves in when they passed the original one, which is now there's something for people to hate. So it's risky to keep a promise. So party leaders have to pay attention to making sure you keep enough promises so that the people who elected you say, okay, well, we want to keep you in power, but not keep promises in such a specific way or so quickly or so specifically that it actually hurts you. And those are the kind of calculations that go into determining what kinds of bills to advance, whether to advance them, which things to put at the top of the priority, and which things that you promised to sort of shelve Does the really ultimately, and this can sound very cynical, but I think it's quite true, ultimately the best thing to do with a promise made is to make it look like you're working hard to keep that promise without actually keeping it, so that you retain the support of the people who want that promise kept, but you don't then lose some of them when you give them a specific version of that policy. So it is often better to be perceived as working really hard to do something make it look like you are actually really gunning for it, but to fall just short, right? To vote yes, but hope no, or to advance something and work on it and make it look like you're trying to keep that particular kind of promise. And that is one, I would say, perverse seeming feature of how it is that partisan calculation goes into the legislative process. This is a good thing to end this lecture on. There is nothing that happens in Congress that doesn't have a partisan calculation attached to it. And that's because elections have consequences, but elections also lead to other elections, and party leaders always want to take the long view and retain for as long as possible their governing majority.